On my left is Commissioner Deb Shore and Commissioner Todd Wilchin. And on my right is Vice Chair Commissioner Larry Hudkins and Commissioner Bill Avery. And I am Commissioner Roma Amundson, Chair of the Board. And will you join me now in saying the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, and thank you so very, very much. And Mr. Clerk, will you begin the agenda, please?
A copy of the Nebraska Open Meetings Act is located on the wall at the rear of the hearing room. Additionally, a copy of our written material to be discussed at today's open meeting is available from the county clerk's staff. The material can also be viewed on the county's website at lancaster.ne.gov. Agenda item one are minutes. Approval of the minutes of the Board of Commissioners meeting held on Tuesday, July 7th, 2015.
Move approval of minutes.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the minutes of the Board of Commissioners meeting held last Tuesday. Are there any additions or corrections? Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Next is number two, claims. Approval of all claims processed through July 14th, 2015.
Move approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the claims. Are there any, is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Number three is a special presentation, Stepping Up Initiative to Reduce the Number of People with Mental Illness in Jails. Kim Etherton, Lancaster County Community Corrections Director.
Here she is.
Okay, there she be.
Would you, Kim, like me to go ahead and read this resolution now?
No.
Okay.
Unless you'd like to.
And Kim, will you introduce yourself, please? Yeah,
Kim Etherton, Director of Lancaster County Community Corrections. And I just wanted to kind of read through something that I've written about the Stepping Up Initiative first, if that's okay.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
All right. The number of people with mental illness in U.S. jails has reached crisis level. In counties across the nation, jails now have more people with mental illness than in their psychiatric hospitals. The leaders of the Council of State Government Justice Center, the National Association of Counties, and the American Psychiatric Foundation are collaborating on the Stepping Up Initiative with a wide range of supporting partners in the fields of law enforcement, policy, research, and behavioral health. Jurisdictions are being asked to consider making a commitment to create a plan tailored to their needs to reduce the number of people with mental illness in jails by engaging in six steps. Convene or draw on a diverse team of leaders and stakeholders. Collect and review data on the prevalence of people with mental illness in jails and assess their treatment needs. Examine treatment and service capacity and identify policy and resource barriers. Develop a plan with measurable outcomes. Implement research-based approaches and create a process to track and report on progress. The Stepping Up Initiative provides resource toolkits to assist in the creation of the plan. The technical assistance resources on the Stepping Up website were developed by the Council of State Governments, Justice Center, the National Association of Counties, and the American Psychiatric Foundation. Currently, in Lancaster County, we do have a number of programs to address the needs of individuals in the criminal justice system who also have symptoms or diagnosis of mental illness. In the late 1980s, just going back in time a little bit, because I think we're pretty progressive around here. In the late 1980s, the level of emergency and ongoing mental health resources was insufficient to meet the community's needs. Individuals experiencing mental health crises were often placed in jails when no other placement was available. LB 257, introduced by Don Wesley, prohibited the detention of non-criminally mentally ill people in the jails and created appropriate facilities for them. After the passage of this bill, the Lancaster County Crisis Center was created and has been operational since 1989. To date, the Crisis Center remains an example of how a variety of community agencies can work constructively together to make a significant improvement in an area of intense human need. In 1999, I was the program manager of the Crisis Center when the Crisis Center was under the administration of the Community Mental Health Center. In 2003, an opportunity was presented which allowed me to take my experience in the mental health field and my experience in the criminal justice field to another level. The Department of Community Corrections was founded in June 2003. The creation of programming at the Department of Community Corrections has been a slow, deliberate process. The programs are currently available, many of which include mental health components, are strong and supported by the judiciary, defense counsels, and prosecutors in this jurisdiction. Here are a few of the programming options available for those individuals with mental health issues. Our local jail, upon booking, will complete a short mental health assessment. Anyone presenting with signs of a mental illness is flagged. As long as their charge is eligible for a program within my department, a follow-up mental health assessment and pretrial release screening is completed by community corrections staff. All of this information is provided to a judge at a bond review. If the individual is released to community corrections, they will be supervised by the mental health specialist on staff. Additionally, mental health case management is offered to all program participants identified, no matter what stage of programming and no matter which program they are participating in. Additionally, mental health jail diversion is available by county attorney or defense counsel referral. With prior grant funding, mental health case management has been added to the adult drug court program, providing a much-needed service in this very intense program process. An inability to address mental health issues in the drug court was one of the reasons many participants were not able to meet the requirements for successful completion and ultimately a graduation. Recent grant funding has allowed additional resources to begin addressing trauma issues that are also very evident and prominent in the drug court population. I would also like to take time to acknowledge the local Mental Health Association and their continued efforts in our community. Over the past 4 years, the Mental Health Association has offered a referral service for law enforcement. When an officer has contact with an individual who presents with signs of mental illness, LPD or LSO can place a call to the Mental Health Association, who will, within 24 hours, follow up with that individual and provide additional resources and referral and peer support. This group also has made visits to the local jail to follow up if that is indicated, and has offered additional support to the Department of Community Corrections when needed. The Stepping Up Initiative acknowledges the important efforts underway in many jurisdictions, but despite these efforts, there's still a need to address the national crisis. I applaud Lancaster County for considering the passing of a resolution to continue to work to reduce the number of people with mental illness in jails through the Stepping Up Initiative.
Thank you, Kim. Any questions or comments?
Oh, very nice summary of where we were when we started and where we are now and what challenges still lie ahead.
It's been a great deal of progress. And Kim, I was going to say, I returned from the NACO convention, the National Association of County Officials Convention in Charlotte, North Carolina, this morning at 1:35.
Oh.
Yeah. We had some difficulties with plane connections, but the Stepping Up Initiative and the things that people are doing for the mentally ill in the jail, with also behavioral, mentally ill, substance abuse, it's achieved national attention. And as I was listening to many of the speakers, I was thinking, we do that. And so consequently, I really want to say thank you for the progress, for the initiative that you have shown in developing these things with the county corrections. Some of the things, there are 79 counties across the nation that have signed on to the Stepping Up Initiative. So with today will be the 80th one. All right. And, some of the things that were brought out was supportive housing, the behavioral mental health care initiatives that are applying, keeping the mentally ill out of hospital, keeping the mentally ill out of jails, I should say, the screening that goes on at the jail right away, addressing the trauma and having the drug courts and so forth. We do so many of those things. And so, Kim, you have just been so progressive in this. Lancaster County has been very progressive in this. And so we compare very, very favorably across the nation.
I would agree, and I appreciate the support of the commissioners.
Yeah. Yes, Todd?
Kim, first of all, I'd like to echo what Deb and Roma said, and I want to thank you for your leadership on these issues. I think Lancaster County and the people who live here owe you a huge debt of gratitude, because without your leadership, I don't know if we would have been in this place. There's obviously several reasons we do this. I mean, and I think people need to understand that it is a cost savings to taxpayers, mm-hmm. because this population, if they don't receive the treatment that they need, they end up being warehoused in our correction facility, mm-hmm. and that's at a cost to the taxpayers. So, you know, there is that first benefit. But I think more importantly, I think it's the right thing to do, that the population is vulnerable, and I think we as a society need to step up and help those individuals who have some type of mental illness. So I appreciate your work. Thank you.
Well, thank you for your support. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, Kim, thank you so much for coming up. And now let's move on to correlating item 5A.
This is under new business, a resolution in the matter of supporting the Stepping Up initiative to reduce the number of people with mental illness in jail.
Move approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we support this resolution for the Stepping Up initiative. Any discussion?
Is there a resolution to be read in the record, or?
Oh.
Would you like me to read?
Yes. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Mm-hmm. In the matter of supporting the Stepping Up initiative to reduce the number of people with mental illness in jail. Whereas counties routinely provide treatment services to the estimated 2 million people with serious mental illnesses booked into jail each year, and whereas prevalence rates of serious mental illness in jails are 3 to 6 times higher than for the general population, and almost 3/4 of adults with serious mental illness in jails have co-occurring substance use disorders, and whereas adults with mental illness tend to stay longer in jail and upon release are at a higher risk of recidivism than people without these disorders, and whereas county jails spend 2 to 3 times more on adults with mental illness that require interventions compared to those without these treatment needs, and whereas without the appropriate treatment and services, people with mental illness continue to cycle through the criminal justice system, often resulting in tragic outcomes for these individuals and their families, and whereas the Lancaster County Community Corrections Mental Health Jail Diversion Program works with individuals pre-booking to divert those with serious mental health or co-occurring substance abuse from incarceration, and whereas Lancaster County Community Corrections screens individuals in custody with serious mental health symptoms for jail diversion and pretrial release for mental health services, and whereas Lancaster County Corrections has licensed mental health practitioners on site and screens and identifies anyone with mental health symptoms at booking, and whereas through the Stepping Up initiative to reduce the number of people with mental illnesses in jails initiative, the National Association of Counties, the Council of State Governments, Justice Center, and the American Psychiatric Foundation are encouraging public, private, and nonprofit partners to find strategies and resources to reduce the number of people with mental illnesses in jails. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Lancaster County Board of Commissioners that this board supports the Stepping Up initiative to reduce the number of people with mental illnesses in jail in order to effectively reduce the number of people with mental illnesses in Lancaster County Corrections, and commits to sharing lessons learned with other counties in Nebraska and across the country. Date of this 14th day of July 2015.
Okay, that is the resolution. We've heard it read. Is there any discussion or comments? Please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Number 4 is a public hearing, amusement license for Murgatroyd Productions to hold the 2015 Nebraska Folk and Roots Festival on July 31st and August 1st, 2015 at Branch Oak Farm, 17015 Northwest 70th Street, Raymond, Nebraska.
Okay, we'll open this public hearing for the amusement license. Is there someone here who would like to speak in support of this? Okay, and please tell us who you are.
Sure. My name is Jeremy Buckley.
I'm going to swear you in. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please go ahead.
Okay. I'm not sure what information you guys need. Do you have questions? And
just tell us a little bit about what it is and so forth.
Okay.
So that the public knows.
Sure.
It's a way to explain it as well as to advertise it now.
Fair enough. This will be our second year. Last year, we hosted it in the rail yard in mid-July on a two-day, I believe it was July 18th and 19th. And we had about 33 bands last year. This year, we want to host it at Branched Oak Farm, which is Northwest 70th Street out near the lake, at Doug and Krista Dittman's property. I believe we sent you guys a map of the space, and we expect to have 500 to 1,000 people out there per day. Music will be on Friday, August or July 31st from 5 p.m. until 11 p.m., and then from noon until 11 p.m. on Saturday, so that we get done at a decent hour. The neighbors are aware, but still wanted to not be volume-wise loud late. We will have some food vendors and other like arts and crafts vendors in the space. Two stages for music, so when one's going on, the other will not, and they'll just alternate throughout the day. So our plan for this year is 8 bands on Friday night and 16 bands on Saturday.
Oh my.
And I mean, the name of the festival, Folk and Roots, that's kind of the genre we're shooting for, a lot of mandolins and banjos and things like that.
That sounds like a fantastic thing. Yeah, Larry?
The LCC said that you're, you know, have good standing with them and that you've done a pretty good job. However, they your application did not clearly indicate where the 1,000 by 1,000 foot fenced area would be. Did you get that resolved?
Yeah, on the map that you guys have, I believe it's labeled number one to where the fenced in area would be with the two stages and all of the attendees. And I think number two on that map is where we would have parking. We've also met with the Raymond Fire Department to let them know what we have in case of emergencies. They're aware of the event for those 2 days, and we have contact phone numbers in case we need to get a hold of any authorities for safety purposes. And we talked to the Lancaster County Sheriff early this year to let them know of our plans this summer, and they were kind of filled in on what we want to have out there for security. Jeremiah Moore, who is here, helped us with the liquor application through the Bourbon Theater, and we're going to be utilizing a lot of their security staff. What was recommended is that we have one security person per 100 people that we expect to have on site, so we'll have at least 10 security people, but we have some on reserve in case, like, I think capacity for what we're allowed to have out there is 2,000. We don't expect to get to that, but we could have up to 20 security people, some paid and some not paid, along with the four organizers for the event that'll be on site for the entirety of the event while it's open to the public.
Yeah.
Well, certainly you've selected an interesting venue. The Dittmans have been very supportive of sustainable agriculture and do kind of a unique operation out there. And that's a lot of people that, you know, you could have 2,000 people or so out there. And we appreciate you talking with the sheriff's office to take a look at security and parking. And this is one time we'll hope it doesn't rain for you.
Right. Or be as hot as it will be tomorrow.
Yep.
We're also going to have, like, mist tents and a lot of water available for free. Or relatively cheap. So we're working with a zero waste initiative along the same lines of what the Dittmans want to do out there, to where we'll have the plastic cups that we use will actually be corn based, so they can throw it into their mulch or whatever, compost. So we're trying to create as little waste as possible. And we're going to have their water pumps out there filtered so that people can use that water and just have access to any hydration that you need for the day.
You bet.
Yep.
As Larry mentioned, that's quite a few cars. What parking arrangements have you made, not only for incoming vehicles, but exiting upon the end of the night?
And we talked with the fire department about that, too. We're going to have quite a few road signs. I think it's Highway 79 that heads out there. Also on Branch Oak Road, Davy Road, and Raymond Road, telling people to mostly enter from the south on 70th Street. And we'll have volunteers stationed at the parking area, which is basically grazing land that they mowed, and they moved the cows over to another section of their farm. And when people leave, we'll have them leave to the north up to Davy Road and then back out to the highway. So people will come in from the south and leave through the north, and there's enough space where you go into the grazing area that people can come and go at the same time.
You mentioned you'd contacted neighbors. How far out did you go? I'm surprised when we did approve the license for Frog Fest the first time, it was very controversial that there aren't neighbors here that are concerned about noise or traffic. Your conversations went well?
Yeah, I know that the Dittmans have been in that space for quite a long time. And one thing that we did in talking to the neighbors was to just offer them tickets to the festival free of cost so that they could come and have a good time. And that's kind of why we picked that 11 o'clock stop time, so that it was still a decent time of night that we're done with everything and it just gets to quiet. So.
And I do want the sheriff to address the concerns that they outlined in the documentation, but I don't
Certainly.
Know if there are other questions for Jeremy.
And I don't know if we have a different map. The map, I'm sorry.
Just go ahead.
I'm sorry. The map that I have shows that you said number one was where the parking or where the fenced in area was. But on my map, that number one shows the main gate.
Okay. And maybe we have an updated map that I haven't.
Do you have one you could put on the Elmo? Do any of you have a map?
I do on my phone.
Yeah.
Is that something I could maybe email?
Good enough.
Maybe the
engineer has one.
Mr. Schroeder has maybe one.
Do you solemnly swear from the testimony you're about to give us the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do. Ken Schroeder, Lancaster County Engineering. I didn't really know what areas was involved in the event, so I asked Kelly to contact the applicant and get us a little better map, and so I kind of overlaid what they showed me on this. I don't know if
it takes a while.
No, it's updated.
Are you on?
Not coming up.
Do I have to hit the button here?
I think you just turned it off.
There.
No, you turned it off.
There for a minute.
Now it's coming on.
There.
There you go.
Okay, very good.
Here's the entrance, kind of on top of the hill.
Off of 70th Street.
Off of Northwest 70th Street. The area that's indicated on the resubmitted map is right in here, which is approximately 800 feet north-south by 700 foot, would probably accommodate the kind of traffic that is planned. The event area is right in here. Mm-hmm. They showed a secondary entrance but in this area, but the driveway is in the residence here. So, and that traffic count on Northwest 70th, when we took the counts in 2011, it was only 41 cars a day, so it's not a very well-traveled road.
And in regards to the fire department, they said that they'll be out at the Branch Oak Lake a lot that day because of the state games that are going on. So they know not to travel on 70th Street in terms of emergencies unless they're coming to us or to the people to the north or south.
Okay.
On this map, that event area will be fenced in, and the vendors will be to the west, I guess the east side of that. This road here, I believe, goes there to there to there, and we're going to be adding gravel, but that will just be for vendors and bands and emergency personnel. And the emergency people know that they can go into this entrance here, or there's also a road to the the west that comes through this non-farmed area. So they have three different entrances that they could come in case of an emergency. And the stages will be in these two corners. So people will be facing either northwest or southwest. And all of the water and the vendors and whatnot will be on this corridor.
Larry?
What type of fencing material will you be using?
If you guys have specific recommendations, we'd happily take them. But we have friends that work at Q&P Ace Hardware on 27th Street. And Trixie, the manager there, showed us a 4-foot like orange fence. It's just kind of a rollout fence. And all the way around this area, right now they have like cattle fencing. Obviously it'll be turned off, but we'll be able to use those stakes to utilize the
So it will be a 4-foot fence, at least 4-foot high.
That's what we were shooting to go for.
Okay.
And in terms of like selling alcoholic beverages, people that are 21 will have paid security, people that are experienced from working at the Bourbon Theater and you know how to check IDs and whatnot.
Will you utilize wristbands?
For people that are 21, yeah. And so there will be a wristband knowing that you paid to be there that day, but you'll have a separate one that you'll get before you can purchase anything with alcohol.
Okay, any further questions? Okay, Jeff, would you want to come up and address the issue of security?
Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I swear. Jeff Blymeister, Chief Deputy, Lancaster County Sheriff's Office. Mr. Buckley, we want to thank you for reaching out to your neighbors, as it's been our experience that's one of the main draws for law enforcement there.
Okay.
During our review, our staff review of both the amusement license and the SDL, our staff noted a couple of concerns. One of which is that Austin Howard and William Spencer Munson, who are listed as supervisors of the event, is that still current?
Yes.
Okay.
And Spencer's here.
And Spencer's here. Or Spencer. We researched those. As far as the SDL is concerned, both have been contacted for liquor license violations within the past 4 years. That is not statutorily prohibitive of gaining this, but just something that we point out during mm-hmm. our assessment.
Sure.
You have provided some clearer guidance today as far as the placement of the 1,000-by-1,000-foot area and the fencing that will be surrounding that, and also the parking issues, as Mr. Schroeder described. With the low volume of traffic, we really don't have any major concerns there. How many paid staff from the Bourbon Theater do you anticipate having?
We were shooting for 5 to 10 per day on the paid side.
5 to 10.
We're kind of going to go with whatever your recommendation would be.
10.
Okay. And do you anticipate having additional volunteers that are serving in that capacity?
Some for security. We're shooting for volunteers for parking, stagehands, cleanup, security, like a lot of varied ways that they can help out.
Very good. Very good.
Anybody that we would expect to help would be experienced in that regard. So whether it's through the Bourbon Theater or another music venue in town, Pinewood Bowl, Vega, any place like that, those are going to be the people that we have. And if you'd like, we could provide a list of who those people are going to be, so you know kind of.
Great. I'll get in contact with you after this meeting and provide you a business card and we'll forward it to our staff.
Great.
Other than that, we have no real concerns over your events, and we hope that it's successful. So.
Okay. Yep.
You did not address the lawn darts for drunks issue that was raised in your letter.
I saw that on the letter. I asked our website person to get rid of that. So if you went to the website now, it's no longer there.
Yes.
I think that was kind of a vague description that he took from another website. And
okay.
As soon as I saw your letter, I said, that's got to go.
Thank you.
And during my review prior, that's why I didn't bring that up. So thanks.
Any further questions? Okay. Thank you. Let me see. This is occurring over the state games as well as the county fair. So you provide another venue for people to go to during that particular weekend. Okay.
Yeah, and we had a really gentle crowd last year, even though it was in the rail yard. You could talk to the rail yard security people, and I don't think they had any incidents outside of what you'd normally have in that sort of area, but it's not a debaucherous crowd. There's going to be a lot of blankets and umbrellas and chairs and kids' activities, and we expect it to be a family-friendly affair.
Well, we expect that you will have a great deal of fun doing that. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
All right, thanks.
Is there anyone to speak in opposition to this amusement license? Is there anyone to speak in a neutral position? Okay, we will close the hearing and go to correlating items 5B and 5C.
5B is an amusement license for Murgatroyd Productions to hold the 2015 Nebraska Folk and Roots Festival on July 31st and August 1st, 2015 at Branch Oak Farm, 17015 Northwest 70th Street, Raymond, Nebraska.
Move approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the amusement license for Murgatroyd Productions.
May I offer a friendly amendment that it complies with the security requirements outlined by the county sheriff?
In other words, at least 10.
Whatever the county sheriff feels is appropriate.
I would certainly accept that as a friendly amendment.
So would I.
I thought I saw indication from the applicant that they were agreeable to that. Okay. Is that correct?
Okay. It's been moved and seconded that we accept this amendment to the motion to approve the amusement license. Is there any discussion? Okay, please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Next is 5C, a special designated license application for Box Awesome LLC for an event on July 31st and August 1st, 2015 to be held at Branch Oak Farm, 17015 Northwest 70th Street, Raymond, Nebraska.
I move approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the special designated license application for Box Awesome. Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. D is a special designated license application for Myers Wine, Inc., doing business as Myers Cork and Bottle for an event on August 1st, 2015 to be held at UNL Farm Site, 3130 North 112th Street, Lincoln, Nebraska.
Is there anyone to speak on that? What are the wishes of the board? Shall we hold this until we have someone speak on this?
That would be my preference. Okay. I would think, unless the deputy county sheriff has some mm-hmm. information, I would think that we need to be have a further briefing on this.
A first-time event?
Yeah, that's what I was wondering.
One second. Paging through my packet. Okay. Jeff Blymeister, Chief Deputy, Lancaster County Sheriff's Office.
Guess my thoughts being when there's an application like mm-hmm. that, somebody should mm-hmm. be here to represent so we can't ask them questions.
Right.
I can speak to our review of the SDL. And so based on our review of the SDL, the number of attendees, and the background of those mentioned on the SDL, we find no reason to recommend denial of this application.
And now it's sounding familiar. It's the Community Cops fundraiser. Oh. And
There's about 200 people you expect, mm-hmm. right?
125 is what they are saying.
But this will be an alcohol event?
Yes.
And I've attended them in the past where they weren't, so I don't know when they changed to this, and are we going to require, fencing, or how do we have any details?
All of those things are stated in the SDL application on how they are, and they should be accompanying to your packet. Mm-hmm. And we do a review of that. Now, we don't know the finite details, as were stated in the previous amusement license and SDL, but we can only go based on the review of the application itself. And again, we have nothing to recommend denial.
Madam Chairwoman, mm-hmm. this yes. is the it's called the Feast on the Farm Community Crops Fundraiser, and you must be 21 to attend.
Oh, okay.
So there isn't a need for a segregated area for fencing for minors.
We have approved SDLs many times for Myers and provide excellent service based upon the information provided. I will move approval of the SDL.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve this SDL for Myers Wine. Is there any further discussion? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
No.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4 yes, 1 no. 5E is a request for Mary Kay Hansen Esquire for payment of attorney fees in the amount of $3,150 pursuant to Lancaster County Resolution Number R-9-106 for reimbursement of Lancaster County by the Social Security Administration in the amount of $26,860 for general assistance provided to her client, James Radeke.
Good morning, Kerry Egan, Chief Administrative Officer for the County Board. There are several new commissioners that are on the board since we've had one of these requests. The county has a long-standing policy of reimbursing attorneys who represent general assistance clients who, at the time they receive general assistance, clients also have an application for supplemental Social Security income. That process is arduous, to say the least, and sometimes will go on for years before an award is made, and in many instances the award will be made retroactively to the period that general assistance was provided by Lancaster County. The incentive of the policy is to encourage attorneys to take these difficult cases because there is a small pot of gold at the end of the rainbow for the county. In this particular case, the county was reimbursed $26,860 from the retroactive award, which went into the county coffers, and we have verified that the county has received that money. Apparently, Mary Kay Hansen had a fee agreement with her client that it would be a $6,000 fee for her efforts in obtaining the Social Security disability designation. So they did receive $2,850 apparently from the money that was left over after the county was reimbursed, and then pursuant to our longstanding policy, which is set forth in resolution 091006, they've made a request for the difference between the money received, which is $2,850 from $6,000, leaving $3,150. Our policy provides that an attorney can be paid up to 25% of the award. So the request here today is quite a bit lower than the maximum that they could ask for under the policy. But based on the fact they had an existing fee agreement, I think that would be fair. And I would certainly recommend that the board award the $3,150 for Mary Kay. I believe that Karen Davison is maybe in attendance today. Somebody indicated there would be someone from the law firm attending if you do have questions.
Is there someone here to speak to that?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
There is reference in this letter from Ms. Davison that we have enclosed correspondence. My file didn't show any enclosed correspondence.
Yeah, I omitted that because it was really detail that wasn't necessary to the, I've got a copy of it, but it's kind of some of the designations from Social Security, some of the rules and guidelines, and it was quite lengthy. I'd be happy to show it to you if you'd like to see it, but it really wasn't germane to the issue of whether she represented the client, whether an award was granted, whether there was an attorney's fees agreement, and the amount that the county did receive. But I do have that. It's, like I say, it's lengthy and basically.
The claim is being made that there was extensive number of hours required to process this case, and the accompanying correspondence was supposed to establish that. That's why I was curious as to why it wasn't there.
That's most likely the detail at the end. Again, I can make that a part of the record if you so desire. It looks like it's 6 pages of billing entries about on the time.
But you agree with the...
Oh, I've read through it, yes. Yeah. I'd be happy to make it a part of the record if you so desire.
No, that's not necessary. Thank you.
Yeah. trying to save a tree.
All right, based upon the evidence or the details provided by Carrie, I would move that we approve item E.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve this request from Mary Kay Hansen. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. F is a recommendation from the purchasing department to issue a contract to Jones Automotive Inc. for the supply and installation of emergency equipment for police vehicles from the City of Omaha Douglas County contract. The estimated cost of the contract is $25,000.
Jeff Blymeister, Chief Deputy, Lancaster County Sheriff's Office. This particular contract with Jones Automotive is based on some extensive research by our staff, in particular Sergeant Brent Moore with our Training and Personnel Division. In essence, this is a cafeteria-style contract that is being piggybacked off of a Douglas County contract with specifics for the setup of our new cruisers. We have done preliminary estimates, and based upon labor costs and equipment costs per vehicle, we're estimating that this contract will save $3,516 per cruiser per setup. It is only in existence until December of this year, at which time we will reevaluate, and if it is beneficial, continues to be of benefit as we believe it will be, we will attempt to renew. So with that, I can field any questions that you may have.
Todd?
Is there a reason why there's only one page in the description? I don't have any details as far as the number of vehicles or, I understand it's a contract, but.
It is not. Brittany Barron's Deputy Lancaster County Attorney. Any purchase, according to the purchasing policy of the board, any purchase over $20,000 comes to the board prior to the contract being drafted solely for a recommendation of award of bid. So at that point in time, you get essentially the recommendation from the RFP of who's being awarded the contract, essentially what the contract and the services are, and there typically is access to what the specifications were. So at this point in time, you are merely authorizing the purchasing agent and the county attorney's office to move forward in drafting the contract. It essentially, past boards chose to enact this policy in order to give the board an opportunity to look at items prior to actually awarding a contract. So that if you saw any issues with the bid or had any additional questions that you wanted the purchasing department or the department making the purchase to look into, that you could do that prior to the time that actual contract was issued.
Thank you for clarifying that, yes.
Absolutely.
And thank you, Brittany, for clarifying that for me.
Yep.
I had a question about the City of Omaha handles their vehicles.
Yes. Now, I can't say that it's exclusively, but the Omaha Police Department does have service work done by Jones Automotive.
And have you taken into account, I'm sure you have, the travel time back and forth in the vehicle? Obviously, you'd have to take two cars up there and two deputies and leave the vehicle and come back and then go back.
Yes, we have. That has been part of the analysis of, there's many different factors that are involved in this analysis, and that is one of them, of the staff time it would take to drive vehicles up there and to bring them back.
Is there a priority system that Jones Automotive will be using? Obviously, you want your vehicles back in an expedient manner.
Yes. In fact, we anticipate that entering into this contract will save at least 30 days of setup per vehicle.
I do have a question in regard to the repairs and so forth and so on. Have you done your due diligence in terms of if a vehicle needs to be repaired? Okay. Do they go back to Jones Automotive because of any type of a warranty or anything like this? Or is this something, how do you choose to work with, because again, you started getting the travel time in.
Correct. So we've had one vehicle that has been set up by Jones Automotive on a trial basis, underneath the $3,000 threshold. And they have come, at this point, they have come down to Lincoln to perform the needed repairs on that. As far as warranty work, that's going to be dependent on what the exact repair is. We have been in conversations with the county engineers who performs our vehicle maintenance, and up to this point has performed the vehicle setups. That is a concern that we both share of, will there be additional repair time because the vehicles weren't set up by the mechanics at the county shops, and we balance that factor when considering this contract. Ultimately, it came down to three or four basic things for the sheriff's office. One, our analysis shows $3,516 in savings in equipment and labor per cruiser. If you estimate that we get 6 to 7 cruisers annually, that's approximately $24,000. Number two, efficiency. Someone, I can't remember who, commented on, do you need these cruisers set up in a timely fashion? How will they be prioritized? And we are under the understanding that during our conversations with Jones Automotive, that there's an approximately 2-week turnaround time per vehicle. When we purchase vehicles, we normally purchase them off of the state bid in a piggyback type of contract. Those vehicles are then have to be upfitted with certain parts that are contained on the state bid. One of those parts is a push bumper. There's others, but that's the easiest one, that have to be retrofitted as part of that original contract. We worked with Jones Automotive and with Anderson Auto Group this last time, where Anderson delivered the vehicle, that Jones performed the upfitting, and therefore saved us additional labor costs not added into this particular number. So that's something that we're working on in the future too. If we can have Jones in agreement with Anderson do the original upfitting, it'll save us labor costs and delivery time.
Todd.
Thanks, Jeff, because I do appreciate the cost savings to the taxpayers. The one other question I had is, I guess I go back to the math, which is if we're saving $3,500 per vehicle, and the contract in total is worth $25,000. How many vehicles, I guess how much does it cost to outfit a cruiser?
So that's two different questions,
right
there.
I know.
So I'll attempt to answer the first one. The first one is this. This is, I'm gonna liken it to a cafeteria style contract in that we can choose to have this particular part installed or this particular labor portion done, or we can not choose that. So this has been, we've worked closely with Bob Walla for the past, well, to be honest with you, it's probably been a couple years. To try to sort out all of these things. We're saving money on the purchase of equipment for the cruisers because of the economy of scale that Jones does. They have large contracts with other public service entities. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the savings. We did as best we could a direct labor comparison between the Lancaster County shops and Jones Automotive, and we also forecast cost savings there. And I'm sorry, your last question
was how much does it cost to outfit a cruiser? I know there's different types of cruisers depending on a canine unit versus a highway vehicle.
So our breakdown shows this. Equipment costs with Jones Automotive, we're estimating $6,793. That's on top of, it's an approximately $29,500 vehicle that we purchase. But that number does not include a mobile data terminal, which is approximately $3,200 to $3,500 per cruiser. It does not include a watch guard camera, which, as you know, we have traditionally purchased with stop or diversion funds, and most recently during our with forfeited assets funds. And those costs are upwards in multiple thousands of dollars. Additionally, it does not include the radar units themselves, which are also multiple thousands of dollars each. So to give you a firm grasp between labor, equipment, it's probably an additional $15,000 per cruiser. Okay. Although the work we're contracting with for Jones is a total of $8,438 per cruiser. Estimated.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep. I guess I will ask, in the interest of fairness, if there's a comment from the county engineer's
yes,
office.
Yes, county engineer.
Pam Dingman, Lancaster County Engineer. I think there's a couple of things. And first, before I say anything else, I want to say that as the county engineer, I do not want to be involved in the sheriff department's management decisions at all. I am lucky enough to have my own. And so I understand that he needs to run his organization. There was several things here that, quite frankly, came as a surprise to us. One, we didn't know a car had gone to Jones. A year ago, when I came to you and spoke at a staff meeting about modifying how we were charging for our time in the mechanic shop, and also said that I was going to make a number of changes in the mechanic shop, at that time, I had told the Sheriff's Department that I would keep a spec in my office about how we put together these vehicles. So because this vehicle went to Jones without my knowledge, that spec was not included. And so I think what we're really getting here is not necessarily an apples to apples comparison, which I have no problem as the county engineer that we compare, because I think we need to be competitive. I think we have to ask ourselves that question for the taxpayer. That being said, the mechanic shop I have completely revamped in the last year. I actually, we had two retirements, which we replaced with one FTE. This department has become much more efficient. But in addition to those two retirements, we also had the very sad death of one of the mechanics. So ultimately, it was my goal to run this department with three FTEs, which I think we can run it with three FTEs. That's reducing an FTE very efficiently. You know, the changing of the shop from billing out $16 an hour for services to $60 an hour did have a lot of unintended consequences in the county. Quite frankly, they weren't necessarily negative unintended consequences. We are now down, I believe, 77 to 79 vehicles that we have auctioned off since we started doing that, because if you have to pay, you know, where you were having a lot of maintenance time on a really old vehicle, but you were only paying $16 an hour, hey, it made sense to keep that vehicle. Whereas now you're paying more of a market rate or cost for that time, maybe doesn't make so much sense to keep that vehicle. I think that saved the county a lot of money. I think that if there is an apples to apples comparison, there that price difference is probably much less. The Sheriff's Department and I met on that last week. You know, as to the efficiency of the 2 weeks, we were under the impression that we use this as filler work, so to speak. There's been some changes. We used to get the cars earlier in the year. We actually only had delivery of these cars on 5/28 of this year. And so, and then actually when we got them, we inspected them, they didn't meet specs, so they had to be returned. There's a lot of details to discuss.
You know,
here. Madam Chairman, just finish my, there's a lot of details to be discussed. But in the end, what I really want to humbly say is that we have a lot of people at the county that are very dedicated and very passionate about the labor they put into these vehicles and about their craftsmanship in the vehicles. So although I think we have to take that into account, again, what I want to say is I'm put in a situation here that's not the best situation. I have staff that are very upset with me. In fact, I believe the union is here today because they're also upset with me. But as I told my staff and as I told the union, this is really a decision by the Sheriff's Department. So I'll close in that.
Okay, I guess in listening to this, the one thing that my impression is that this information is something that should have been brought to the staff during a staff meeting on Thursday rather than on a Tuesday. And I think that you have presented information regarding the changes in your particular department. And I think that I would like to see a more complete analysis on a Thursday before we make a decision on this. That is my specific impression. Larry?
If Pam would still stay there too. I guess I find it pretty hard to figure that we would have a savings of $3,516 per car. It just doesn't seem like they could do it that much more efficiently in Omaha than we can here. So I wonder about these figures, if they're actually accurate. But I do know it has been, you know, a change, but we did ask you to adjust your rates out there at the county office to be more reflective, because how many years was it that they weren't changed? Probably.
It was like 82 or 83, I believe.
Yeah, so that, you know, part of that lays on us, but I guess I too would like to have more information on the difference. And from the sheriff's office, I certainly understand, and you need to be efficient on what you do too, but one of the questions that was raised here is that warranty work, moving a vehicle back and forth to Omaha, there's a cost of time and manpower to do that.
I don't know what your question is for sure there, Commissioner Hudkins, but what I will say is there's an extraordinarily large amount of details here on both sides. And, you know, the sheriff's office has studied the details on their side. We have provided the details on our side. And of course, if there's more details you want to know, as an engineer, I guarantee you I can provide you with as many details as your heart's desire. But I really think, again, that the decision goes back to the sheriff's department.
I would agree with that, but I think in the interest of the county, I think it's appropriate at this time. I would make a motion that we table this item pending a review at a Thursday staff meeting.
And I will second that motion.
It's been moved and seconded that we table this particular discussion.
And I would request that all the statistics and numbers you provided verbally be provided in writing.
Okay. Can I just make a comment on that before the motion is voted upon? There's been many comments made today in this public forum that we definitely take exception to. And this discussion does more appropriately need to be at a staff meeting. Mm-hmm. That is on me in my conversations with purchasing. And we will bring those numbers, but I can assure you that when our staff did this in-depth analysis, it was towards the benefit of our office and the taxpayers of Lancaster County.
Okay, I think we do have some other. It's been moved and seconded that we table this particular discussion, but I do think that you would like to make a comment.
I would. Rick DeBoer, Ask Me, 2468 Union President. I appreciate the fact that the board is tabling this discussion and motion until further information is brought. And I appreciate the fact that the Sheriff's Department is looking out for the taxpayers. I do appreciate that. 2 weeks ago, Sheriff Wagner was here before the board fighting for his employees. And it's kind of ironic that the equality of benefits that he brought is the same number of the savings that was on the when he brought the equality of benefits to all the people in his department, it was going to cost the taxpayers $24,000 more than what the original had been, and now they're saving $24,000. So I'm glad that they are looking out for their employees. I'm glad that they're looking out for the taxpayers, but as an employee of Lancaster County and as the union president, it's my job to look out for the employees as well. We do a great job. We have top-notch mechanics. And if you compare apples to apples, and I'm sharing with you now because I know I won't be able to attend the staff meeting on Thursday. But we have top-notch mechanics. And if you go apples to apples, I'm sure that there will be enough savings from our department that it will not pay for them to go to Omaha to get this work done. And I would just like to remind the board of Article 7 of the engineering contract, Section 1. The union recognizes that the right of contracting and subcontracting is vested in the county. The right to contract or subcontract shall not be used for the purpose or intention of undermining the union or to discriminate against any employee. You're taking away jobs here. And if you start contracting out, it becomes a very slippery slope. I know Gage County contracts motor graders. Maybe that will happen to us someday. I hope not. Before you make that decision, go ahead and drive south. Drive those Gage County roads and see once what we have in Lancaster County compared to what they do in the counties surrounding us. We have a wonderful sheriff's department, a wonderful engineering department. I think they can work together and come to an agreement on this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Rick. Oh, one more? Okay.
And that is something that I should have said earlier, Chief Deputy Jeff Blymeister, is that Bill Fleischer, Jim, the mechanics, and the management at the shop itself, absolutely, we have a great working relationship with them. And during our conversations, which have been upfront, including the first vehicle that went to Jones Automotive, we've taken that all into account. I want to affirm that we believe they do an excellent job at that. And that particular part weighs heavily in this, but was not part of the decision making of efficiency and cost savings to the county.
Okay, thank you. We do have a motion and a second to table this particular recommendation. Is there any further discussion? Okay, please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0.
Okay.
5G is a recommendation from the purchasing department to issue a contract to National Everything Wholesale for janitorial and sanitation supplies, equipment, and related services. From the City of Tucson, Arizona, contract number 151148. The estimated cost of the contract is $150,000.
If I can, I'll sign that later. Gary Aldridge, Lincoln, Nebraska. I saw this yesterday when I peeked at the agenda on the internet and scratched my head a bit. 150K is not couch change to me. Perhaps it is to some people. Janitorial and sanitation stuff, that's stuff I have at home, so it's reasonable and necessary. The thing that confuses me is the city of Tucson. I did not investigate the B150031. I'm guessing this was a bid contract. I don't know if it was an open or closed bid, but was there no private company firm in the local trade area that could offer these services to the county or city or whomever? You might want to explain that to me, and not only to me, but perhaps to the people who are watching, about why you're going to Arizona, Tucson, Arizona, to get these, to get this contract fulfilled.
Good morning. Vince Majors, City County Purchasing Agent. The City of Tucson bids out a large cooperative contract for all governmental entities in the United States to piggyback on to get the volume discounts. Generally, there is a local company that provides the stuff from the national wholesaler. Mm-hmm. So there is a local, right now I can't tell you who it is. I didn't look, I just assumed this was going to fly right through. So best I can tell you is it was a cooperative formal bid process done by the City of Tucson.
If I remember right, some of the email correspondence your department department reached out to all the different entities that utilize these janitorial supplies, and the response back was that they were pleased with the service.
There were some glitches. Every contract you have that, and we just need to work out those glitches.
And we contract with cities all over the country to get the best price on a wide variety of items.
Yes.
Okay, yes.
Well, I think, Vince, you brought up that there are local vendors who utilize that contract and pass along those cost savings to the county. So
yes,
we just don't have those that information readily available.
Yeah, the company that won the City of Tucson's contract has dealers in the local area, and they pass on that savings to the local.
Okay.
Based on the recommendation, I would move approval.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that we approve this recommendation from the purchasing department. Is there any further discussion? Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. H is a recommendation from the purchasing department and the county extension office to award a contract to Bizco Technologies for audiovisual equipment per specification 15-146. The total cost of the contract is $54,761.09 for the initial project package 1-3 and $17,204.56 for figure option package 4 and 5.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve this recommendation for the contract to Bizco Technologies. Any further discussion? Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. I is to authorize Pam Dingman, Lancaster County Engineer, to notify the Nebraska Department of Roads that Lancaster County intends to accept its highway allocation revenue for fiscal year 2015-2016 to help address local road and bridge maintenance and construction needs.
Pam Dingman, Lancaster County Engineer. So this is new legislation at the state level that says if we're going to receive our funds that have been allocated for us, we have to write a letter and ask for them.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
So it's one of those nuances. What I think is interesting is Department of Roads has assured us if we forget to write the letter and ask for our funds, they will still give them to us. I'm a little skeptical of that. But in writing this letter, I talked with Carrie Egan, and we really felt that I should have board approval to write this letter to ask for the funds.
Yes, Larry.
Engineer Dingman, we at a workshop for the county commissioners all across the state a couple of weeks ago were advised about this. The question was, in front of the new director of the Department of Roads, why obviously all 93 counties are going to need and want these funds, but just a new step that they put in, we don't know why. We asked him to look into it and see why we have to go through this red tape, but I think you're wise to ask us, and we want to make sure that it's on record so the state doesn't have an excuse not to forward those funds to us.
Right, Commissioner Hudkins, and I think it's important to note out, although I will comply with Department of Roads criteria, they have a lot of reporting criteria that we comply with, in particular with the 1 and 6, and then they have a SARS, which is sort of like our CAMS but a little different. They both end up being about several hundred pages in their reporting. You know, we do have counties that don't have admin people that decide that that is a little too cumbersome for the amount of money they're going to receive. That's their decision. That's not my decision.
You bet. With that explanation, I'll move approval of the authorization.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we authorize Pam Dingman to write this letter. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Shore?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. J is authorization for Pam Dingman, Lancaster County Engineer, to sign the annual certification form for Lancaster County for the period of time from July 1st, 2014 to June 30th, 2015, in accordance with Section 5 and 6 of the Federal Aid Transportation Fund Purchase Sale Agreement between the State of Nebraska Department of Roads and Lancaster County.
So this is the agreement for our federal funds, and since it's an agreement, I bring it forth to you to ask for permission to execute the agreement.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we authorize Pam Damon to sign this annual certification form. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudson?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Abstain.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4 yes, 1 abstention. 5K is a contract with Spies Lewis Engineers in the amount of $10,100 for repair of County Bridge T-171 located at Southwest 14th Street, 180 feet south of West Sprague Road.
Pam Dingman, Lancaster County Engineer. So just to refresh your memory, T-171 is the bridge that is just south of Sprague. It's the bridge that we did have the truck fall into. It's the bridge that we did the emergency repair, and I want to clarify, this was not a temporary repair, an emergency repair where we just kind of on a non-technical level dumped some dirt and rock in there. Now we need to come back and actually do the engineering study to figure out how we're going to shore in the abutments on this bridge. So this is the engineering study for the future construction.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve this contract with Spies Lewis Engineers. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. L is a contract with H.R. Bookstrom Construction, Inc. in the amount of $596,965 for culvert pipe maintenance.
Pam Dingman, Lancaster County Engineer. This contract is coming forward for approval just a little late this year due to some of the flooding issues that we had earlier in the year. So this is our annual contractor culvert replacement contract. So there's been a few modifications in this contract to make the process a little more efficient as we go, just the similar to what we've talked about with the box culverts. In other words, that the contractor will be providing the fill over the pipe and the erosion control and the seating all around the pipes so that they will be responsible solely for the pipe in the future.
Move approval.
Second.
Been moved and seconded that we approve this contract with H.R. Bookstrom Construction. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. M is a grant contract with the Nebraska Crime Commission in the amount of $181,420 for the coordinated response to reducing violence against women in Lancaster County. The county will provide an in-kind match of $51,481, and the Lincoln Police Department and Family Violence Council will provide $18,477 for a total project cost of $251,378.
Move approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve this grant contract with the Nebraska Crime Commission. Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. 5N is submission of certification form for the Nebraska Crime Commission stating Lancaster County is in compliance with the Equal Employment Opportunity Plan requirements, stating an EEOP utilization report has been submitted to the Office for Civil Rights for review. Certification is required for recipient of certain grants.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we submit this certification form to the Nebraska Crime Commission. Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. O is an agreement with Region 5 Systems for emergency protective custody services at the Mental Health Crisis Center. Region 5 will enter into separate agreements with referring counties who will send acute mentally ill individuals to Lancaster County. The county will be paid $186 per individual per day. Term of the agreement is July 1st, 2015 to June 30th, 2016.
I would move approval. And I'd welcome any questions afterwards.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, it's moved and seconded that we approve this agreement with Region 5 Systems. Yes.
I have a question about the amount we are reimbursing. 186, is that the amount that we were in dispute about before?
No, Bill. What this amount is, this is the amount that we pay per day for individuals who are at the crisis center. This is what, as counties, we are required by state law to provide. The issue, that dispute, was about the county and their contribution to the crisis center outside these funds. So what was happening before was, and I asked Scott Atherton and so did Region 5 to figure out who's utilizing the crisis center, the calculating number of beds that were being used, and then identifying which county those individuals were from. And we figured out that in the prior years that Lancaster County was paying more per bed than the out counties were. And so at Region 5, we approved this contract for all 15 counties. And so what it does is for the out counties, it increases the daily amount that they're going to pay. And that way the taxpayers of Lancaster County will, it was more of an equitable, because it was determined that over the last few years we were paying 90% of the cost versus the 10% from out counties, when in reality the out counties were utilizing the beds 25% of the time.
Yeah, now I remember the briefing you gave us at the staff meeting.
Larry?
I'm going to support the motion too, and I want to take this opportunity to thank Commissioner Wilchin for all the work that he put forth on this. We've been trying to address this formula and get a more equitable solution for Lancaster County for many, many years. Thank you, Todd, for doing this. It's only fair that everybody using that facility pay their fair share. So,
okay. It's been moved and seconded that we approve this agreement with Region 5 Systems. Is there any? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin? Yes. Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. 5P is an agreement between the State of Nebraska Department of Roads and Lancaster County for the provision of transportation services for the Lancaster County Public Rural Transit Program. Term agreement is July 1st, 2015 through June 30th, 2016. Funding is from the Federal Funding for Public Transportation Operating Assistance Program and the State of Nebraska Department of Roads. The cost to Lancaster County shall be remaining eligible costs not paid by federal and state funds and shall not exceed $18,964.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve this agreement with the State of Nebraska Department of Roads in Lancaster County. Is there any discussion?
Yes. Just would state that I did attend a session at that last NACO conference out in Kearney on this, and I have seen it many, many times where our seniors are able to stay in their own homes because they can get to those doctor's appointments, can get to groceries and those sorts of things. But further on, as our new director told us last week, this isn't just for the elderly. There's other people, and you can go from one town to the other. It's just not from these towns into Lincoln, and they'll accommodate you as much as possible. So that service is there. It's a wonderful service. So make sure everybody knows it and use it as best they can.
Okay. Any further discussion? Please call the roll.
Shore?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Q, a subgrant agreement between the Nebraska Department of Health and Human Services, Division of Children and Family Services, Child Support Enforcement, and Lancaster County on behalf of the Clerk of the District Court for the Child Support Enforcement Title 4D State Program. Term of the agreement is October 1st, 2015 to September 30th, 2016. The Department of Health and Human Services will reimburse the county $366,045.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve this subgrant agreement between the Department of Health and Human Services and Lancaster County. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. R is the annual telephone technical support contract with Jantech Electronics in the amount of $750 for the Youth Service Center. The service contract includes unlimited technical support via telephone, fax, internet, and email. Term of the contract is July 8th, 2015 to July 7th, 2016.
Move approval.
Second.
It's moved and seconded that we approve this contract with Jantech Electronics. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. S is an amendment to County Contract C-14-171 with Family Violence Council for the Safe and Sound Trauma Response for Juvenile Study. The amendment extends the end date of the grant contract to June 30th, 2015.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve this amendment to the county contract.
Isn't this a little bit late?
I had that question one time, too.
Brittany Behrens, Deputy Lancaster County Attorney. We often receive notice from the Crime Commission on state and federal grants that the grant term has been extended in order to fully utilize the federal funds and to give us more time to complete the expenditure of those funds. Oftentimes, the notice doesn't correspond and comes after the term of the agreement has already passed. But in order for the county clerk's office to process payments to the vendor that we have a grant contract with, they need a current contract. There's no way that bills could be submitted for payment after the previous December deadline in the earlier half of this calendar year. So this just allows those bills to be submitted and the remainder of the grant funds to be paid out.
So it's not irregular.
It's unfortunate, but it is not irregular.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Is there, you had the question answered. Please call the roll.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins? Yes. Bree?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. T is an amendment to County Contract C-13-495 with Data Shield Corporation for document shredding services. The amendment renews the agreement for an additional one-year term from July 15th, 2015 to July 14th, 2016.
I would move approval.
Second.
Move and second that we approve this amendment. Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. U is a refund request of personal property tax from Women's Clinic of Lincoln, PC.
Good morning, Scott Gaines, Deputy County Assessor, Register of Deeds. Recommending approval of this request with one clarification. The request for refund actually comes from it's Olympus America, Inc. This is a situation where we had a lessor and a lessee. I'll spare you some of the technical details, but they both reported the same item of equipment, and this is the what would be the lessor asking for the refund request, and they will receive the request. It'll be reported by only one of them at that point and in future years as well.
Okay. That explanation, I'll move approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve this refund request. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. 5V is the setting the salary of Elizabeth Carpenter, bailiff for the Honorable Susan Strong at $48,023 effective July 6, 2015.
I'm Joe Kelly, Lancaster County Attorney, and I've talked with Judge Nelson and others at length, so that's why I'm talking to you first about this issue. And in fact, I'm the one that got us to the point where we're at today. I regret my timing because now, after a lot of conversations with the judges that I've had, I think it's really created quite a stir and quite a difficulty for them with their current employees, with their new employees coming on. In other words, somebody was offered $59,000 and hired at $59,000 and and it is a request that that's what that person should be paid. Here's my position today. I haven't altered any of my position about what I see as a need for Doug McDaniel and personnel to take a look at this unclassified position to see A, if there should be steps, and B, what the proper salaries for those steps would be. I think that's appropriate. I think that's the way we treat other classified employees. I think there's counter arguments that I've heard from the judges about that. I think all of those arguments are best served in a calmer setting when we aren't in the middle of a hiring where each side can make their pitch to Doug McDaniel, because it shouldn't be the county attorney, as I find myself today. I think the more in the middle of this, I think it's more desirable that personnel, the neutral party in this, be involved here, making those decisions and listening to both sides, and then making the recommendations to you, the board. For that reason, I am asking you to support the request from Judge Nelson and the district court to pay this new employee at the $59,000 whatever, and then for the next employee who comes in the door to know full well, and the judges to know full well, what the county board is authoring for a salary then. And I'll be the first to admit that the court, members of the court, understood, as they told you, that that was the salary, that it was 59, and that that's what they were to proceed on with the hiring. I think it's reasonable for them to have had that understanding. I think it's the rushed timing of it all, my finding it on the agenda for the next day, my appearing from you, that put us to where we are today. So to that extent, I apologize for bringing it up with that timing. I do think my concerns are legitimate, and I'll submit it there and allow Judge to address you, or if you have any other questions of me. Yes.
You would be willing to work with us to perhaps set up a whole new system for bailiff reimbursement or pay compensation?
No.
I think Doug McDaniel, I'll do anything that Doug McDaniel asks. Again, my entry into this issue had only to do with my paralegal twos as they stacked up against the bailiffs. To that extent, yes, I'd be willing to get in the middle of it. But what I'm suggesting today is I don't think the county attorney should be as directly involved in setting jobs for the descriptions, for the steps, or for the salaries outside of my office. But if anybody needs anything from us, you bet. You bet.
Okay, Todd, and then Len.
Well, thank you, Madam Chairman. My question has to go, and one of the arguments you brought up was the impact that this would have, and I just brought it up last week with the judges, which is the fairness issue, which is one of the arguments you presented was that the paralegals and the new hires in your office, that my concern is moving forward that how will this have an impact on the morale in your office? Mm-hmm. And I mean, it would also have the same issue in the public defender's office.
I've got good employees. That's nice of you to ask that. I think they'll be fine. I mean, I'm not gonna fabricate and tell you that I think they'll quit or that they'll not do their job as well as they can or that they won't try and be a good part of our office. I mean, these are employees who are great and will remain great. But if they know that the board is at least taking a look in the future and asking personnel to take an independent look at this and listen to their side of it when it comes to their salary, I think they'll be fine.
Larry?
Mr. County Attorney, we appreciate that you brought to our attention that this, you know, creates a further problem on down the line. But is it not the county board's authority to affix the annual salary for the bailiff? Is that not our duty?
Yes, you do it annually, and that's by statute. The judges did some of their own research confirmed, because this is just not an issue that we've looked at for many, many years.
And I think that's our problem. We haven't looked at it as closely as we should have.
Certainly on the first day that I talked to you, I hadn't looked at that statute, and I wasn't really aware that we set that each and every year.
But I think we as a board need to be aware of it. We set some fairly strong parameters for ourselves to bring the bailiff salaries up to what we thought was a more acceptable level 5-6 years ago. We started that, and I think maybe we have reached that parity level or something, at least to where we need to take a look. And so that's our reason for asking personnel to take a look at that in the future. So I think that's probably, you know, what we'll do, and it's as much our fault as it is. Maybe it is yours, but thank you for bringing this to our attention.
Okay. Would you like to go ahead?
Jody Nelson, District Court Judge. First of all, I want to thank Joe Kelly for coming and visiting about the greater topic here. We have two topics before the board here. One is up for a decision, and one is not. The one that is up for decision is, what are we paying the newly hired bailiff for Susan Strong, who just was appointed as a district court judge? And when she hired her bailiff, she offered that job at the resolution of the county board for what the salary is. It's one salary. It's one salary for all of the bailiffs, and it's the salary that you resolved back in January for that position. That was what it was offered at. This has been done similarly, not in the too distant past, with a couple of other bailiff hires, and we did what we thought we were supposed to do, which was set the salary at the resolved county board's resolution salary. We did. We presented it the same way we presented this one, and then we were surprised when all of a sudden there became an issue about this. I don't fault Joe Kelly for that, in the sense that the second topic is the one that has gotten a lot of play, and that's the second topic about, is there parity within the county employee system for similar jobs, and what are similar jobs? I agree. Those are absolutely conversations that should and do take place in an organization, certainly in an organization like Lancaster County. It should. That's not the topic today. The topic today is, what is the salary for this bailiff? And I think the fair thing to do, and I thank again Joe for stepping back and realizing the two topics, the fair thing to do is to hire her at the salary of that position, which is $59,012 annually, consistent with what you have resolved previously and consistent with what the statute requires. And that's why we gave you the letter signed by all but two of us, only because they were not in the office yesterday. They also agreed, and so I wanted you to know that. But that's what we're here asking for you to do today, is to resolve that salary issue for Liz Carpenter, Judge Strong's bailiff, who, by the way, is already on the job, not yet been paid, and haven't submitted a PA for payroll because of the issue. And then the second topic, I want you to know that we are all willing to engage in and participate in that conversation with you. We wanted to let you know that last week. I wanted to certainly confirm that this week, that that is a conversation we are certainly willing to participate in fully with you. So that's what I have to say.
Okay, any comments? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we need a motion and a second.
I would, Mr. Egan or the administrator may know the exact amount, because I said 59,000, and I don't know what
59,012 is exactly.
Okay.
If that's your motion. So.
And that is correct based on the last resolution of the county board, $59,012.
Okay. So What is the wish? What are the wishes of the board?
Well, I move that we approve this salary at $59.12, with the understanding that we will undertake an investigation and study of the appropriate compensation for bailiffs in the future.
I would second that.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded that we approve this specific salary, and we'll investigate further in the future.
And I mean, no disrespect towards the activities of the personnel department, but I don't think they've ever come back after a job equalization study and recommended a smaller salary. So I think the board needs to be prepared for that.
Okay, please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Number six are consent items. Receive and place on file the following reports for June 2015. Records and information management, county assessor, registered deeds. Receive and place on file the Railroad Transportation Safety District statement of receipts and disbursements for 2015.
Approval.
Second.
Been moved and seconded that we approve the consent items. Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Shore?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Number seven is public comment. Those wishing to speak on items relating to county business, not on agenda, may do so at this time.
This may be one of the few meetings when you're glad to see me, because you know this shebang's about over.
Well, thank you, Gary.
Gary Aldridge, Lincoln, Nebraska. I would appreciate if this board not spend money I do not have. No one really likes taxes. Show me a person who likes taxes, and I will show you a person in critical need of competent psychiatric help. Unlike Captain Renault, who was shocked by the obvious, few today are shocked because citizens are grumpy about taxes. Everyone has a different theory on salvation. Raise taxes, lower taxes, shift taxes, spend more, spend less. Most recognize tax as verb or noun is a burden of citizenship for safety's sake. Two articles in the local press on different subjects that, after all, may be connected. Quote, county officials close to filling budget gap. Arbaresque, 10 July. And farm income to plummet, Bergen, 8 July. Nebraska is a low population, mostly aggravated in a handful of geographic locations in a large area state. Large parts of Nebraska are empty. Those empty areas are given over mostly to production agriculture. Most in production agriculture, traditionally I think, are loyal to one political party. A political party or faction that promotes as salvation, less. And yes, in theory, less is fetchingly fetching. Until citizens expect and or demand better, more, newer, or just adequate. And so spending increases, or rather does not decrease. And so taxes are stubborn and static, or rather do not decrease. And every year political subdivisions struggle to balance the books. Pity or not that poor political subdivision when the books don't balance. If past is prologue for Lancaster County, the books balance when one taxing subdivision beggars another taxing subdivision. Spending mirrors revenue, almost as if spending discipline is an asterisk or footnote on the balance sheet. Political subdivisions must have spending discipline. Alas, government cannot be all things to all people. On fiscal policy, i.e. tax and spend, for some, most, all political subdivisions, next year will be business as usual. The goose, as required by law, will provide or produce gold eggs, and also from time to time less charming indelicacies. Ain't democracy beautiful? Taxpayers, citizens are warned that Lancaster County is facing a budget gap, a revenue shortage, not a spending excess. Perhaps one explains the other. The budget gap once again places a county taxing authority in peril, in jeopardy. A pledge, sincere or otherwise, to not tamper with a political subdivision tax levy is or was illusory. And what then of the legitimacy invested by citizens in fiscal policy? County officials estimate or predict tax revenues may indeed be up. Estimates and predictions sometimes double cross. Couple that with farm income to plummet, and some may say, be careful, very careful, what you wish for. Political subdivision or subdivisions, for some, is a taxing authority with an expectation of a regular pay raise or cost of existence adjustment. For those in production agriculture, a pay raise or living adjustment comes mostly or only from shrewdness, being able to outguess the weather and markets. Those are long odds. Generally, even in full employment Nebraska, I sense unease or discomfort in those at work. Job security and employee loyalty may be a relic found now in museums. I would ask for one additional minute of tolerance for a point of personal privilege. The oldest son of my oldest son, my oldest grandson, plays varsity baseball for Pius. I've shared that with you in the past. Pius did very well this year, winning Class B championship. Most high school teams will have a summer program, American Legion ball, that has sponsorship. The Pius varsity plays this year as Union Bank. They were at a wooden bat tournament in Blue Springs, Missouri last week, Independence, Kansas City, and they won. So they've gone up and down. The district playoffs start Thursday, day after tomorrow, and that involves, my wife says, that involves all of the local high schools. And I think most of you have some part of Lincoln that you represent, and maybe even a high school. The play is going to be, and I don't know what the times are, I hope the Journal Star is correct when they print that. They've had some problems in the past. But the play is going to be at Sherman, and if you're familiar with Sherman, it's a cozy field. There's a canopy so you don't burn up in the sun. There is concessions, flush toilets, and real grass. I mean, what more can you ask for in baseball? You might want to think about coming, looking at the schedule, and coming if you have, if you, you're probably running to somebody that you know. If Union Bank's playing, I'll be there. And perhaps we can swap some knee-slapping stories about Kerry Egan or someone else. Anyway, thank you.
Gary, thank you for bringing that to our attention. And you might be interested in that this Lancaster County Board of Commissioners, through the Visitors Promotion Fund, helped pay for the renovation of Sherman Field. It had been deteriorating for years, and a lot of good kids get a lot of good use out of that, so we did contribute to that renovation.
I think you're going to see a lot of good athletes there. Some of these young men, in fact, I think are going on to play a scholarship at certain universities around the state and perhaps other locations.
Well, we wish your grandson great deal of good fortune.
Thank you.
I would move. Oh, sorry, never mind.
Next is number eight, announcements. The Lancaster County Board of Commissioners will hold a staff meeting on Thursday, July 16, 2015 at 8:30 a.m. in the Bill Luxford Studio of the County City Building. The Lancaster County Board of Commissioners will hold their next regular meeting on Tuesday, July 21, 2015 at 10:30 a.m. in room 112 of the County City Building, with the Board of Equalization immediately following. County Commissioners can be reached at 402-441-7447 or commish@lancaster.ne.gov. The Lancaster County Board of Commissioners meeting is broadcast live and is rebroadcast on Tuesday and Saturday on Five City TV, cable channel 5. In addition, the meeting may be viewed on the internet at lancaster.ne.gov under Five City TV, video on demand, or Five City TV on YouTube.
Now I would move adjournment.
Okay.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we adjourn. Please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4-0.
Okay. The meeting is closed, and now we will open up the Board of Equalization meeting. Now.
A copy of the Nebraska Open Meetings Act is located on the wall at the rear of the hearing room. Additionally, a copy of relevant material to be discussed at today's open meeting is available from the county clerk's staff. The material can also be viewed on the county's website at lancaster.ne.gov. Also in attendance this morning is Scott Gaines from the County Assessor's Office. Agenda item 1 are minutes. Approve the minutes of the Board of Commission, the Board of Equalization meeting held on Tuesday, July 7th, 2015.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve the minutes of the last meeting. Are there any additions or corrections? Hearing none, please call the roll.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4-0. Number 2, additions and deductions to the tax assessment rolls.
Move approval of the additions and deductions.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve the additions and deductions. Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4-0. Number 3 is a public hearing for motor vehicle tax exemption applications. This is for Villa Marie School.
Okay, we'll open the public hearing. Are there people speaking in support of the exemption? In opposition to the exemption? In a neutral position? We'll close the public hearing.
I would move approval of the motor vehicle tax exemption applications.
Second.
So moved and seconded that we approve the motor vehicle tax exemption application for Villa Marie School. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Shore? Oh. Wilchin?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4-0. Number 4 is the Lancaster County's 3-year assessment plan for 2016 through 2018.
Scott Gaines, Deputy Assessor, Register of Deeds. This is a statutorily required plan that we're to give to the Department of Revenue each year, and a copy to the board each year. It outlines what our 3-year plan is, and just like always, our complete reappraisal occurs every third year. This just outlines the steps that will be taken in the intervening 2 years, and as well as the next reappraisal in 2018.
Larry?
Any other specific details of it that you can give us at this point?
No, it's basically, Larry, the same thing that we've, same process we've been utilizing for the last several years.
And do you do commercial 1 year, residential, agricultural, or?
All classes every 3 years.
B3.
With study of the other classes in the intervening years to see if adjustments are necessary. You know, the ag land adjustments have fallen into that category either by our choice or state choice in the last 3 or 4 years.
Yep.
Todd?
Scott, I'm a new county commissioner. I just want to use this opportunity for you to kind of explain, because the 3-year cycle does have an adverse impact in governing, because, and you can see in the Journal Star today, there was a story about the Lincoln Public Schools. And so every 3 years, can you explain to the public and I guess for our benefit, why is it done on a 3-year cycle and not done every year?
I'm probably not the best one from our office, but I'll give it a shot, Todd. In essence, what we do is we calibrate all of the models and look at the most recent sales information. To do that on an annual basis is really not realistic, in just because of the scope of the project that would be involved and would be more costly. And so what we do is maintenance of that model in those intervening years, still looking at sales that are occurring, and identifying if those values from the previous model still get us within the statutory required parameters. So our level of value, we still have to look at and say, are those values still meeting the standards set out in law at 92% for residential and 69%, 72% midpoint for ag. So there, it isn't like we just do it and then we walk away and don't do anything in the next 2 years. It's the constant upkeep and determining what needs to occur when we hit that reappraisal year. That's the best I can do. It's, if we did it every year, would there be smaller movements? Absolutely. But it just it really isn't feasible to do it that way with the current setup.
Well, it's just because a lot of people, when they do see that their valuations go up in those off years, you know, that creates questions, which is what I mean. And I know that
when they go up in the intervening years,
yeah,
mm-hmm. And usually that's triggered by some construction taking place on the property. Yep, that if your house is sitting there and there hasn't been movement in that particular market in the intervening year, you're not going to see an adjustment typically. Now, Agland is a good example where you look at what's going on in the market. If the market continues to rise, then you will have to make adjustments to those classes or subclasses that have been impacted more urgently than that three-year cycle would allow.
Bill?
You will be doing next year field inspections of 1/6 of properties in all classes.
By law, we have to inspect each property within 6 years. So each property we have to have an inspection within 6 year period.
So how do you determine which properties are included in that 1/6?
I wish I could answer that more intelligently, but I know it's scheduled by the appraisal staff, and they've got neighborhoods they'll look at. And part of it is I think the sales activity will dictate which neighborhoods they look at first. But and again, I'm not the best one from our office to answer that question for you, Bill.
But with that, let's say you had property tax protest that was successful, would they be in that 1/6? Perhaps
I don't think that would be a factor we would look at. It might be if we had an area where there was a lot of adjustments that might trigger it. But you know, just saying okay, let's go look at all the protested properties, I don't think that would necessarily drive it up.
But I do know it's not a random process.
I think it's more geographically based mm-hmm. than you know, broad geographic based than anything else. But that would be a good question. I'll visit with Rob Ogden, and if there's if I've misinformed you, we will get you more specific, accurate information.
Larry?
Well, I want to compliment you and your office on the explanation. Along the people in the agricultural community have had three major raises in the last 3 years, and they were under the understanding, you know, that once every 3 years their property is evaluated. I think our homes and the home site that we in agriculture occupy are pretty much under that type of system. But the ag land, as you mentioned, by order of the state, your office and this board appealed even the state this year on these raises that they had, but they came back and said that's where the market is. Even in the face of declining revenues, those taxes still went up and declining production. So thank you for explaining that.
And I think one thing we run into is that when they measure all the counties, they're measuring sales that have occurred in the rearview mirror, sometimes 18 months old. And so we always kind of run into that. Their reaction takes a while to be reflected in how they measure what's going on in the market. But our role is to kind of reflect what the market is telling us and not to you know, look that far back in some cases. And that's why there's sometimes a disconnect between what we believe the current market is and what the state analysis shows.
One more.
Yes, question. Bill.
What do you mean by pickup work?
That's a trade term, I guess. If you new construction means picking up new stuff that's been permit have been issued for.
Okay, got it.
Okay, some good explanations. Thank you. Do we have a motion?
Not yet. Okay.
I think you need a motion. It's just to.
Oh, just to evaluate. Oh, an FYI. Very good. I like FYIs. Okay. Okay. Number five is the notice of the assessed valuation.
This is one we found. It's rather unique that there's a garage sitting on this property or on a property. It appears it sits on property A. It's actually part of property B. We've been carrying the garage for unknown number of years on both. So this is our recommendation that we fix that problem, remove that garage from the parcel that does not own that garage, and make those valuation adjustments as far back as we're able to under the clear statutes, which is this year and the three prior years.
Was this brought to you by the property owner?
I believe it was, and I don't know if it came through in a protest, but I know they were in contact with our office, and then we encouraged them to follow this process.
Larry?
Was there an incorrect survey, or was the garage actually on two properties?
In visiting with the appraiser, he said if you drove up there, you'd say that garage goes with that house. I don't think there was an incorrect survey or anything. It was probably just
oversight over the years.
Was it a property that had been in existence for a long time?
I believe it's not in a newer area of town, okay. So I'm going to say it's probably 50-plus years.
Yeah, and lots of those lots were really difficult, too. Okay. And this is just a notice, right?
And this will be a notice to the homeowners that we've adjusted the values accordingly to fix the problem as far back as we're able to go.
And this is an FYI also?
Yes. Well, okay. you'll need to take action to approve.
Oh, okay.
It's a board notice that will go out.
Okay.
And then what you'll see next week, assuming you approve this, next week you'll see the corresponding tax list correction that will show up on your list.
I move that we authorize sending in the notice of assessed valuation change.
Second.
Move and second that we approve sending this notice of assessed valuation change. Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Hudkins?
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Amundson?
Yes.
Motion carries 4-0. Public comment. Those wishing to speak on items relating to County Board of Equalization business not on agenda may do so at this time.
Seeing none.
Move adjournment.
Second.
Moved and second that we adjourn. Please call the roll.
Yes.
Avery?
Yes.
Wilchin?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion carries 4-0.
Oh, we need to sign documents yet. Oh.